goes away. Hopefully we can get into thinking about our Lord as he reveals the subject of the church this morning in this lesson. I want to make it a simple lesson. Not complicated, simple. I want us to see some things which should be obvious to us but may not be obvious to us. And the first thing I want to tackle is the idea that when religious people identify the building as the church, other people are misdirected and confused. So we really do need to clarify once again what the word church means in the New Testament. The question is, can it apply to the building? Well, there are a few passages of Scripture which would make a nonsense out of that. And I want you to look first in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 19. Okay, actually, just drop back to verse 3 to 5. 16 verses 3 to 5. Greet Prisca and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who for my life risked their own necks, to whom not only do I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Also, greet the church that is in their house. Think about that. This is Romans chapter 16, verse 5. It says, also greet the church that is in their house. So what we have here is, it's saying, let's sort of illustrate it if we can. Here's the house. I know it's a little bit more like our houses, but anyway, and now, if the church is the building, then he's saying, here's the church in the house. Is that what he's saying? Is that what he's talking about? Of course not. Of course not. It's obvious that the church in the house can't be a building, because the house is the building that they're meeting in, and the church cannot be a building under these circumstances. There's more than one place where it says this with regard to church being in the house. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 19. It says, the churches of Asia greet you. Aquila and Prisca greet you heartily in the Lord, with the church that is in their house. Now, these two people, Aquila and Prisca, moved around quite a bit. They were in Rome, and then they were in Ephesus, and but wherever they went, they obviously were well off. Wherever they went, they had a home, and they started a work in which they could allow those who were converted to come to their house to worship God. And it just speaks volumes of the type of people that they were in regard to their faith in our Lord Jesus Christ and their effort to preach the gospel and to establish churches wherever they went. And it's as difficult and as simple as they make it. Because you think, well, you'd have to be a preacher, or you'd have to be an elder, and you'd have to have all sorts of experience and all the rest of it. It doesn't require anything of that. It requires somebody with real faith who trusts God and says, look, Lord, I want to do this for you. I want to save souls for their sake as well. And I'm going to preach the gospel. And if I'm the only one, then others will come in and we can meet together and worship God. So they had a church in their house as well. It's just the same deal. Is the church the building? Of course it's not the building. There isn't the building in the house. What's in the house are the people. Colossians chapter 4, verse 15. I'll read 14 and 15. Luke, the beloved physician, sends you his greetings, and also Demas. Greet the brethren who are in Laodicea, and also Nympha, and the church that is in her house. Now, here's a woman who is obviously well off enough to have a home of her own. And when it came right down to it, she also wanted to use the facility of her home so that brethren could meet together to worship God and to glorify God and to be edified in the truth. So it's not just the male who's gone out and done this job. This woman was ready to do her part in letting her home be used for worship service. Now, Philemon, and we know it's coming to the back of the Bible, Titus and Philemon. If you turn there to Philemon, verse 2. I'll read from verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved brother and fellow worker, and to Apphia, our sister, and to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. That's Philemon's house. Now, we know Philemon was a man of means. We know that he had servants because one of his servants had run away and escaped and went to Rome. And there he met the Apostle Paul and heard him preaching and was converted. And Paul had a dilemma now on his hands because this man called Onesimus, he was the one that had run away, and he was giving a great service to the Apostle Paul in helping him in obviously doing, getting the messages for him, looking after him whatever way he could. And Paul decided what he needed to do. He needed to go back home to Philemon. He needed to say he was sorry for what he had done, and he probably had taken some stuff, maybe money or property or whatever else it was, and he needed to repay that. And Paul, the Apostle Paul is trying to say, look, I'm sending them back to you so that you might send them back to me of your own free will, because he's a great help to me. And now he's a brother in Christ, and that should help to reconcile both parties here. So he did that, and this was the letter that he sent to him in order to get him to do what was right in these circumstances. But there was a house in Philemon's place, the house of Philemon, and there was a church in that house. And the church was not the building. The church were the people in the house. All right. The church, if I have to give a definition, the church is the saved In other words, those who had believed, those who had repented, those who had confessed Jesus Christ as Lord, and those who were baptized for the forgiveness of their sins. They were the saved, and the saved who come together to worship and serve God in Christ, they constituted the church. That's what the church is. You and me and all of us together here, we are the church. We are the congregation. We are the assembly. Those are terms that are applied to the church. We're all of those things. But it's a coming together, brethren, not a separating ourselves from each other. It's to come together and unite together as one voice in praising God, as one mind, as we have the Lord's Supper and remember the death of our Savior Jesus Christ. We are together when we're hearing the Word of God, because we're trying to understand God's will so that we might apply it in our own lives. And I'll say that to you so that you will remember. Don't be thinking about how this might apply to everybody else. I want you to think about how this applies to me. Is this my understanding of the church? Is this the way I think about it? Look in Acts chapter 2. We know Peter preached on the day of Pentecost. And it says in verse 40 of Acts chapter 2, "And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation." It's a wonderful statement, and you can feel the intensity of his preaching as he solemnly testifies and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. And sometimes that has to happen. Sometimes there has to be a driving of the people to get them to do what the Lord wants them to do in order that they might save themselves from this perverse generation. We're not only saved from this perverse generation, we're saved when we are saved. We're saved from the wrath to come. We're saved from the dominion of Satan and his kingdom. We're saved from our sins. We're saved in so many ways. We need to understand how important that salvation is to us. And it gives us an identification, or a way of identifying with each other. I'm saved, you're saved. We're both saved by the same gospel, by the same God, by the same Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We are a family in Christ. We're a family in Christ. And we need to be learning how to act like a family in Christ. Because if we don't learn now, how are we going to manage it when we get to heaven and we're all there with each other and we can't get on with each other? There should be love. There should be generosity. There should be grace and forgiveness. There should be a desire to identify with each other, to build each other up. That should be all of those things. It should be there within us, and it must be a desire in our hearts to do just that. When I'm here and I don't want to be here, I'm not doing that. When I'm here and I'm resentful and angry and frustrated, you're not doing it. You need to work all of that out so that you would know what you should be doing. When I'm not encouraging, and I'm resentful that nobody comes to encourage me, then you're thinking the wrong way. They haven't got the responsibility to encourage you. You have the primary responsibility of encouraging them. And if everybody's doing their job right, all of us will be encouraged. I'm talking about what we are as a church when we come together, the saved come together as one to worship God and to glorify his name. Look in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 17 through 21. The Apostle Paul writes to the Corinthians, but in giving this instruction, I do not praise you because you come together not for the better, but for the worse. Here was a congregation in the first century who was coming together, but they weren't coming together for the better. They were coming together for the worse. And we need to be very careful that that's not the case. And I need to be able to say and to do the things that will bring about the community or the fellowship of each other with Christ Jesus our Lord. So we need to come together for the better, not for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, see, here's the saved coming together as a church. This is what we are doing this morning. This is what needs to happen when we get the opportunity to come together. It's sad when we don't want to come together, or when we find excuses not to come together, or whether we think we have justification for not coming together. There's an obligation on all of us to be here when we come together. There's an obligation to worship God. There's an obligation to show Jesus Christ your submissiveness and your desire to be at one with him. There's a desire to build each other up and to love one another. And all of those desires can only be fulfilled when we get together and we're able to do it. I see in some parts of the world, there's a problem now after COVID. Brethren think they can still be on Zoom. Very handy. Just press the button on a Sunday morning. There we go. Just press the button when you're finished, and that's it. You've done your duty. But what I did was, when we started this thing, I said we will have a Bible study on Zoom because we're not getting together. We can't get together. It's not possible to get together under these circumstances. But I didn't want anybody to think that that was a substitute for getting together. But if you didn't learn that in the initial stages, you might think, well, it's just as easy to have a Zoom meeting as it is to have a worship service. It's not. It's easier for you as an individual, but it's not as the group. We need to come together as a church, physically be present with each other as a church in order to carry out the will of God. Okay, so what we're seeing now is the church is not the building. The church is the people, and not just any people. It is the saved, those who have believed, those who have repented, those who have confessed Jesus as the Lord, those who have been baptized for the forgiveness of sins. They're the people who are in Christ and are showing by their coming together that they belong to Christ and that they are unified in Christ. But there are other passages which are helpful as well in knocking the idea, and it's a very prevalent idea that the church building is the church. Let's go to Acts chapter 5, verse 11. Most of us will know the story of Ananias and Sapphira. At the time, there was a great need in Jerusalem. There was a lot of people who had come from all over the world to worship God and who were converted on the day of Pentecost and wanted to stay on in Jerusalem. So there was a lot of people in need and in need of help. And the congregation that had grown up quickly there in Jerusalem decided that they would sell properties that they had and they would donate the money so that these people could be helped out. Now, there was a great spirit of in the brethren, and they wanted to share everything, and they wanted everybody to know that we don't consider anything that is our own. It's part and parcel of what we have and what we want to share. So that's what they did. But there were these two people in the church, Ananias and Sapphira, his wife. And we're told in verse 2, they kept back some of the price for himself. He kept it back with his wife's full knowledge, and bringing a portion of it, he laid it at the apostles' feet. Now, there was nothing wrong with, when they sold the property, there was nothing wrong with them holding back a portion, if they were not lying and pretending that it was everything they got for that piece of land or that house. They pretended they gave everything they got, but they had kept it back secretly, him with the agreement of his wife. Both were guilty. Both were guilty. Peter said to Ananias, "Why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back some of the price of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not under your control? Why is it that you have conceived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God." Now, if anybody needed a lesson on lying, this is a great lesson. Because we think we can lie and it's of no real consequence. It gets me out of a difficulty, or it makes me look smart, or whatever else or intention you had when you were lying, you think, not a problem. When you're lying, God hears you. And he's a God of truth. And he wants us to speak the truth, not only verbally, but he wants us to speak the truth in our own mind. He wants us to be truthful people. And if we don't learn that lesson, we are in big trouble. He wants us to be truthful people. What happened here was, when he heard these words, verse 5, Ananias fell down and breathed his last, and great fear came over all who heard of it. And his wife came in a little bit later, and there was a recurrence of the challenge to her and of her falling down dead. And as a result of all of this, verse 11 says, and great fear came over the whole church and over all who heard of these things. Now, I don't see in this passage bricks and mortar shaking with fear, which is a silly thought, of course, but it's as silly as calling the building the church. I don't see that in this verse. What we see is the great fear came over the whole church. In other words, all of those who had assembled, all of those together who were saved and justified in Christ Jesus our Lord, all of those who had communion with each other in Christ Jesus and now had assembled together, and they had great fear because of what happened. But I just want to add to this, because there's a great lesson in it. We think fear is a terrible thing. We don't want to be fearful, but there's sometimes we need to be fearful. There are times when we need to really be fearful, and especially in our dealings with God. We really need to be fearful in our dealings with God, because it's the only way that we will be able to serve Him acceptably. He loves us. He sent His Son to save us. He's done everything in His power to bring us to eternal glory. But He's God. He is God, and He's way beyond us. He transcends everything in the universe. He spoke it into existence. He's obviously greater, much greater. He holds it in existence. We're dealing with a being who is beyond our imagining. And we need to be fearful of displeasing Him. And lying displeases Him. It says that on the positive side of things, Proverbs 9 and in verse 10, Proverbs 9 and verse 10 talks about the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding, we're told. So that sort of fearful, reverential respect for God needs to be in our hearts. It needs to be in our lives. We need to be aware of it every day, because we're living in God. We're living in God, and we're trying to be pleasing to God. This is a mindset, brethren. You can let this go in one ear and out the other, but you've made a mistake, because there's nothing in there that can pass right through. That's what's wrong. You need something to stop it and listen to it and take it to heart and realize, I've got to get myself right with the God whom I serve, who is my Savior, my Lord. I need to get things right here and stop playing games with God. Ah, yes, Lord. I'll worship you when I feel like it. Ah, yes, Lord, I'll study your word when I feel like it. Yes, Lord, I'll tell the truth when I feel like it. You're not serving God, you're serving yourself. You're self-serving. We need to get God and hold on to God and understand God. That he is an awesome being, and it will be a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. That's if we're opposing Him. And there's little reminders along the way that this fear is important. 1 Peter chapter 4. He says in verse 15, make sure that none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a troublesome meddler. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, he is not to be ashamed, but is to glorify God in this name. For it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. It starts with us. He says then, it begins with us first. And he says, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? Well, if we're going to have this sort of judgment on us and punishment for the wrongs that we do, and experience this in our lives. And you know, most of the troubles that we're having in life are the result of our own stupidity and disobedience to God. They're not just things that are happening in life. We've caused them to happen. They're the result of what I'm doing or saying or thinking or behaving. It's all a result of it. And God has to allow those consequences come upon us to wake us up. Sin brings trouble into your house and into your life and into your mind. Sin brings that trouble. We need to understand that. We need to try and be forgiven of our sins. Otherwise, we're going to find that there's a judgment on us, and rightly so too. He says in verse 18, a sort of surprising statement, "For and if it is with difficulty that the righteous is saved, what will become of the godless man and the sinner?" The difficulties are going to be that you're chastised for your wrongdoing. And hopefully those wrongdoings are not that frequent or that often or that plentiful. We need it to be something that just is a mistake. It happens. But for the people who are godless, and they're doing it every day and every minute of the day, and God is still gracious to them because they're able to cope with the things that cause problems for them in their lives and never understand or see the connection at all between what they're doing and who they are to what they're suffering and why it's happening. Okay. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 9. Paul says, "For I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God." Paul ravaged the church. He persecuted the Christians. He took them, he arrested them, he had them put on trial. He even stood by the crowd that stoned Stephen and looked after their coats while they were doing it, or cloaks while they were doing it. Paul was a real adversary to God and to the church. But there's been persecutions on the church. And there will continue to be persecutions on the church and on the individuals in the church. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, 10 through 13, 2 Timothy 3, 10 to 13, he says this, "But you follow my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, perseverance, persecutions and sufferings such as happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium and at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and out of them all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. But evil men and impostors will proceed from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived," he tells us. So although the church is persecuted, with the Lord's help, we can be delivered from these persecutions. He is warning us that anybody who wants to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. And most of you who are out there working among the people of our society, if you stand for anything that's truthful, or anything that's right, or anything that's moral, and you say that that's what you believe and that's what you would teach, you're going to get opposition. You're going to be isolated. You're going to get people who are not going to like you just because you stand for the truth. And these things hurt. We are humans after all. It hurts. But think about it. If they did it to Christ, what do you expect? And is it not the case that it's because you are of Christ that they're persecuting you? They don't realize that, but that's true. That's the way it is. So, you can't persecute a building. And even if you did try, it doesn't feel anything, it doesn't know anything. So, the building isn't the church. The persecution was on those who were saved and those who met together to worship God and to serve God. Now, there's quite a few other scriptures. I just want to look at one more, and that is Acts chapter 11, verse 22, which I thought was an interesting passage of scripture. Acts chapter 11, verse 22. This was saying, men of Cyprus and Cyrene who came to Antioch and began to speak to the Greeks also, which they hadn't done prior to this, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. Now watch this, verse 22. The news about them reached the ears of the church at Jerusalem. Now when you were walking in this morning, did you see any ears on this building? Well, it's just an interesting way of phrasing it, but the ears of the church, of course, it came to the people's attention, and especially the apostles' attention. So they sent down people to see what was happening there. Now, there's a lot of other things. The church prayed. The building can't pray. The church was to be shepherded by the elders. The church was to give no offense in whatever they do, and the church was to be edified, and the church is to be subject to Christ. There's all passages that relate to all of these things. I haven't got the time to go through them all now. You just have to take my word that this shows that the church is not the building. It is absolutely the congregation or the people who assemble together to worship God. Okay, now, the church has two aspects to it. The first one is there were local churches. Local churches. We can see a few passages here. Acts chapter 15, verse 41. Since you're in Acts already, just turn a few pages and look at Acts chapter 15, verse 40. What did I say? Acts 15, 41. It must be 21. Got the wrong verse. I don't know what I'm doing here. I'm trying to show that there were other churches, local churches. That is, let's maybe go to Romans chapter 16. Romans chapter 16. Yeah. Here in verse 4 it says, "Who for my life risked their own necks, to whom not only do I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles." All the churches of the Gentiles. Look at chapter 16, verse 16. "Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you." What happened in the beginning was, when they went to different places, they preached the gospel. People believed the gospel, and people were saved from their sins. As the saved people, they came together to form a church in that place. And they constituted the church. Then they moved to other towns and other places and did exactly the same thing. And they started a church in those places. So eventually it got to the point where there were churches all over Judea. There were churches in Samaria. There were churches in Corinth. There were churches in Ephesus. There were churches in Asia. There were churches all over the world. And these churches are very important. These churches were the people of God. And this was the organizational aspect of the church. It was a local congregation. A local congregation separate from another local congregation. Say at Ephesus or at Smyrna, there was a congregation or congregations and congregations over in the other place, and congregations wherever the church was established, there was congregations all over the world. And each of these congregations were local churches. They were separate from each other. They were independent. They were self-governing and self-sufficient. We know they were self-governing because there was a command to go to the churches that had been established and to appoint elders in every church. This happened after the first missionary journey in Acts chapter 14. It says in verse 23, "When they had appointed elders for them in every church, having prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed." These elders were also known as bishops, elders, shepherds, and as a group, a presbytery. Those were the different names given to the same group. These men were to be the shepherds of the congregation. It had an organizational structure. That we know that there were deacons who helped them. These were servants who would help the elders in doing the looking after the congregation, looking after the building, doing the physical work, and helping out in the teaching and so forth. So there were elders and deacons and saints in each congregation. That was the organizational structure. And the organizational structure fitted each congregation. This was the pattern that God had set down in the New Testament. This is the only working church or organized church that we find, a local congregation. A local congregation. Now, we know that there's the word church is used in a way that is greater than the local congregation. It's used to describe the universal church. the universal church. And we're able to see this in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 23. It says, to the general assembly. I better read from verse 22. But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to myriads of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood which speaks better than the blood of Abel, we're told. So, here's the church universal. It has no organizational structure. But what it is those who have been saved, who are now in a relationship with the Father through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's that spiritual relationship with God that constitutes, all of those brethren together constitute the church or the body of Christ. Or the body of Christ. Because the body of Christ has to be the universal church. But it's not an organizational structure. It is, listen to this, it is a saved relationship with God Almighty. If we look at, I haven't got the time. We've pretty well run out of time, but you can see the church is spoken of in that universal sense, a spiritual connection with God the Father through Jesus Christ our Lord, and it's spoken about in the local sense where it is organized, where it is organized into congregations that are self-independent congregations, self-sufficient, and who have their own elders and deacons, and who can get on with the business of worshiping and serving God in their own locality. That's what the church is, and that's how it's described in the New Testament, and that's what we must believe as the Church of Christ. There's nothing beyond what we read about in the scriptures. Now, although we're independent, we're bound together by our common faith and love and our submission to our Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. We would share that in common with all the other congregations of the world. We're bound together in that way. But that's just the lesson. It's simple, it's straightforward. It is, the church is not a building, it is the saved people who assemble to worship God. If you've got that, you've got the message. And that's what I want you to understand. I'll leave it there for today. Thank you.